Overtones of the Soul. Dramatic enough for me, I guess. This will be a concert of my original pieces as well as a lecture to start with. And why don't we just go ahead and get started with that? So, my lecture will be titled The Case for Quarter Tones. I'd like you to start by thinking about the pianist keyboard. I think most people here looking at a keyboard can tell me some details about it. It's got 12 keys per octave, about 7 octaves on the keyboard with a little bit more on the end. There's a lot of harmonic ability you can make with just these 88 keys. If you found every single individual combination of notes, it would take 309 septillion notes or chords just to complete every single combination of piano. It's quite a bit. So you would think that with such a large combination, we would have unlimited potential of music. And I would disagree with that. I feel that, yes, there is technically septillions and septillions, it would take the whole universe 700 times over to finish everything. Even with that being the case, I feel like there is a lot more potential. If you look at the 20th century especially, composers began getting super experimental. Some of them pushed so far out that audiences who previously were very fond of classical music maybe started recoiling a little bit. You get this really harsh, dissonant music. I think a lot of that was born of boredom. You can imagine putting a kid in a large sandbox and they can play around with it. Over time, they grow, they explore the whole sandbox. Eventually, there's not really much left to do, so they start throwing sand outside the box. Well, I would like to introduce... Oh, sorry, I forgot. Ivan Vyshnogradsky is a composer I'll be speaking quite a bit about today. I'll introduce him a bit more later. He was a composer who believed that music was on a continuum harmonically. We started in the 12th century with perfect intervals, lots of fifths and octaves, and as time moved on, we started introducing thirds and sixths and more dissonant intervals until about the late Romantic, where we had all tones. In the beginning, things were quite different. We didn't have perfect equal temperament like we do now, and E-flat wasn't really the same as a D-sharp, so chords shifted a lot, and things were very relative. This changed when Bach didn't invent this, but he really helped solidify it. In the late Baroque, the well-tempered clavier came along, and it was really only performable if he had 12-tone equal temperament. Vyshnogradsky felt that this was a very important point for Western music, but at the same time, it is kind of limiting because it creates an artificial boundary. These are the 12 pitches you get to work with. There's nothing else. You can't really go outside of that without technically breaking something. So what if there's no alternatives? I think there are plenty. I think there's music out there that it exists in between what we see now. We call this music microtonal music, meaning that the steps between keys is smaller than... What if there's a note between that? Maybe there's a B half sharp, things like that. And that's actually the book, a book that came out in the 30s. Here's Vyshnogradsky again. I will be basically touring through his book, showing you some examples of how music works in a new tuning system. This is his Manual of Harmony in Quarter Tones. And let me tell you, it's very difficult getting an English version of this book. So let's begin with accidentals, the part we all love. There are many different ways of notating accidentals. Different composers came up with different methods. I feel that the most successful method and the one that's most popular is Cooper's. So if you look carefully here, we have the quarter. Well, I say quarter, it's really a half sharp, or a half flat, meaning the note goes down half as much as it normally would. Here's a 1.5, or as I put, 3/4 flat, meaning it's a flat plus another half. You have a half sharp, which I think is pretty easy to take a look at, and then also the 3/4 sharp, which can alternatively be notated with 3 dashes on both sides. Vyshnogradsky, his methods, he tended to use the previous one, and if you take a look here, you can actually see some of the flats at play. The problem I have, like here's one up here. The problem I have with them is they're difficult to read when they're printed. They look, flats look a lot like half flats. So I will be using Cooper's in my examples. So let's begin with some notes. Because everything is tuned in what's called 24-tone equal temperament, meaning there are twice as many notes in an octave, we have twice as many notes per interval. So between C and D, we now have four pitches rather than just two. From D to G, you can see there are 10, and there's even a half sharp that's between B and C. So when you're doing your theory homework and you wrote B sharp and you meant to put a C, maybe you could just argue you were trying to make a microtone. But what's it even sound like? Let's take a look at a 24-tone chromatic scale. Those of you that are familiar with 12-tone probably were on the edge of your seat waiting for it to reach the octave. It takes much longer to reach an octave than traditionally. And it takes a bit of time for you to get used to the accidentals, but I hope by the end of this lecture you'll be able to read them a little bit more clearly. Let's look at some more things. Because we have this, we can make some new what are called symmetrical scales. We have plenty of symmetrical scales in our music. Chromatic is the one everybody knows. What about the whole tone scale where you have two steps between each note? There's not really too much else you can do with besides that. You can do major thirds and you can do minor thirds, but after that you start passing the octave or doing weird things. In microtonal music, however, you get plenty of unique sounding scales. So one of my favorites is the neutral second scale. Let's hear the scale first. Here's what I like so much about it. If you look at every other pitch, you actually get a diminished third. I know it's a B natural, it should be a C flat, I'm sorry. So traditionally, if you move between diminished chords, it might sound something like this. Let's see what it sounds like when it's in this key though. People tend to just think it's out of tune. Maybe it is. Maybe I'm just crazy. Let's move on. Here's another one, the super major second scale. A super major second being a half step, a quarter step larger than a major second. So C to D, half sharp, things like that. Let's hear this one. Use. The dash means sub, the plus means super, semi, and again super, but it's in a little bit different context. So first we get the neutral chord, which is halfway between major and minor. Here's sub minor, it's lower than a minor chord. Don't be afraid, or sorry, be careful not to confuse that with. Sounds really similar to a suspended two chord, but it's not quite. Super major, slightly larger than a major chord. Semi diminished, the top two are only halfway lowered rather than fully. Semi augmented. Super diminished. And finally, super augmented, which almost sounds like a completely different chord. It almost sounds like an F major chord. All right, let's move on. Oh, I didn't make it into the slide for some reason. I'm going to show that again. What I did is I went from a major chord to a semi-diminished to a fully diminished, so you could hear the transition. With this increased harmonic ability, you get some very unique cadences. You can colorize our Western music far more than we could do right now. For instance, we have a kind of Neapolitan sixth chord. It has kind of a groaning quality to it. Or even better, what about we take a French sixth chord, and there are actually 27 ways of altering this in microtones. I'm not going to show you all of those. But first, of course, I should show you what a normal French sixth chord sounds like. Context. Very old school. But you can actually start playing with the tones a little bit. You can either mess with, well, technically you can mess with any of the notes to a degree. The root can be altered, technically the root. The augmented sixth can be altered. Third, any of these tones can be moved and you get these new sounds. So let's look at the second example with the D half sharp. One with three quarter sharp. And finally, one where I also move the root a little bit. About a ninth of how many different French sixth chords you can make if you start writing the 24 tones. Imagine how many different emotional contrasts you can create with that. We also have new key signatures. I don't generally like using them too much though. They're kind of confusing. Like for instance, you have B half flat major. The B half flat and E half flat should be pretty logical, but because of how microtonal music works, you actually have to half sharp every other tone. So the chord, the keys tend to look kind of scary, and so in this modern day, you know, who uses key signatures anymore anyway? So there still are new chords we can move to though. For instance, here's an example from his quarter tone manual: C major moving to E half flat major. This is an introductory manual. He has a couple way crazier books that I wish I could talk more about. There's one called Ultra Chromaticism and Non-Octavian Spaces. Maybe another time I'll talk about that one. But we can start getting into a little bit more colorful examples. Let's start pushing tonal harmony. Here's an E minor. It starts in E minor and it's going to end in F three quarter sharp major. Standardization there is in 24 tone, you can imagine there's like way less for anything else. And a lot of this music is recreated electronically, so generally you don't see scores for things in these new keys. But Mr. Grodzki, of course, wrote plenty of music with these. So you can see 48 tone, and in this system, you can see the halfway points. There's the quarter sharp, there's the regular sharp, three quarters, and then there's a double sharp at the end. But you also get these right in the middle. I like to use an up carrot. It's a little easy. It's pretty easy to see. 72 tone is not as easy to see. You can see right here, there's the half, regular, three quarters, and double. But now you get two between all of those. So you get 12th tones. There is some music in it. It's very, very crazy sounding. But why don't I actually give you some real world examples instead of just this electronic stuff? The first is from Cosmos. It's for two pianos. The way that Mr. Grodzki would create these, because these all came out way before electronic music, he actually would take two pianos, I didn't do this, and he would tune one of them down a half step, or a quarter step, or he'd take three of them and tune them in different ways, and he'd basically conduct them as an ensemble. There's not really a way of doing it otherwise. This Cosmos. Towards the ending of Dithyrambic, is one of my favorite pieces from him. You're going to hear an example of him using C major, or it's something around C major. And then he's going to shift to C half sharp major. You're going to, it almost feels like a tape is being sped up a little bit. Sensation quarter tone in 12th tone. I'm not smart enough to do this kind of music yet. Maybe someday I can write this. But you might hear in my music in the next hour inspiration from this kind of music. So that wraps up my lecture. Thank you. Sotot's hymn. You're probably going to see a little bit of a theme. I love Lovecraft. I read him all the time. So there's a lot of Lovecraft imagery in my music. There it is.
Thank you.
This one, Lovecraft was well known for having night terrors. They plagued him. It was very daily life. He could barely left his house, and most of the things he wrote about were actually his own nightmares. So I wanted to kind of capture the sense of one of these things. Sorry, I forgot to ask him.
Thank you.
images of blood and steel and things like that. Sometimes my pieces evoke really shocking, I don't know what it is, something in my head pops when I play certain things, and I try to exploit them and make something out of it. So, Blut Waltz there, roughly translates to Blood Waltz. I use Google Translate, I don't speak German. So, it's kind of a minimal piece. I feel oppression when I hear it too. There's a lot of darkness in this piece. So.
Thank you.
Passacaglia. So this is a piece that I wrote, it was conceived in the back of a car, like a lot of great things that happen. It's a, I was going to my great-grandfather's funeral in Illinois. I wasn't ever really too close to him, to be honest, but for some reason, the whole feeling of it, you know, a major member of our family died. I was just compelled to write this piece. So this is my first piece I actually wrote here at IUSB. And we'll grab the performance.
Thank you. Thank you.
I couldn't fit a full orchestra in here, I'm sorry, but I was able to make a piano reduction, a two-piano reduction of Nyarlathotep. Here's another one of Lovecraft's great things. Nyarlathotep was an Egyptian-ish god monster thing. Not very pleasant sight, really. There's a short story where he basically was resurrected by Egyptians, and he came and terrorized Egypt and caused great horror and monstrosity. There's a small snippet of the final paragraph, which is very visual, in the end. So I think that's enough for you to kind of get an idea of what the monstrosity is like. And pair with it, in another one of Lovecraft's stories called The Dream Quest of Unknown Caddis, the main character actually finds Nyarlathotep and